Sir, thanks for coming on with us.
Good to see you. How you doing? Nice to be on.
Good, good. Give us your take on Obamacare. I mean, I've gone over the sections. All that bad stuff is in there, or it points at boards that we know do carry out all this rationing. We know what happens in Canada and England and Germany. That's on record. You can watch the House of Commons on C-SPAN and see them admitting it. I mean, as a doctor, give us your snapshot of this program, where you see it going, and why you're saying it borders on eugenics.
Well, I think the big issue here is that it starts in the wrong place. I'm getting more and more disturbed about it now that we're seeing, you know, these religious references, and everyone that doesn't agree with President Obama is somehow bearing false witness. I mean, how awful is that? I mean, you know, I think that the whole discussion is misguided. First of all, anybody understands in the United States that if we're going to change something, we need a debate. So it's very suspicious that if you disagree with the president and the administration, somehow you're wrong. I mean, where's the debate then? There's got to be something to discuss. And what about practicing physicians who are in the trenches every day with patients and see where this is going? You know, I'm not an insurance salesman. I work with patients. I have to deal with insurance, public and private. So why isn't the administration more interested in the fact that practicing physicians are having a problem with this? We don't think that government insurance works that well. We don't think that Medicaid works well at all. We don't think Medicare is working very well.
Well, they're admitting, doctor, they can't even read the 1,300-page bill. Conyers admits that. I mean, how can they implement something if they can't even read what was written by special interest, A, and then B, going back and backing you up? We have them all over the news now as a mantra saying, you can't even call it socialism, or you're a racist using the N-word. They are weaponizing politics, terrorizing the public, and invoking racism. They're actually the ones using race. They're the ones that are engaging in racism, race pimping.
Well, I mean, I think that we have to get back to basics here. You know, what are the basics? The basics are, whether they like it or not, health care and health insurance are not the same thing. I mean, why? Americans understand that. That's one of the reasons we're having the problem we're having. Americans understand that. They own an automobile, and they know if they bring their automobile in with a scratch, their rates are going to go up. And if they try to bring their automobile in with a scratch too much, they're going to find out there are no repair shops around taking their insurance. That's something we've lost sight of with health insurance. Health insurance is the problem. It's not the solution. And government-run health insurance is absolutely the worst. So it's completely disingenuous to have this discussion without looking at what real healthcare needs are. And one thing is, and this is where I get very upset, there's a great shortage of physicians in the United States. There's an estimated 40,000 primary care physicians we're going to be lacking in the next 10 years, and you can probably triple that given the fact that we have 78 million baby boomers coming in. Then let's piss off physicians more. Let's cut them. Oh, don't worry. We're not cutting benefits to patients. We're only cutting benefits to the poor guy in a Medicaid clinic who's already doing cataract surgery for free and saw his reimbursements cut down from $1,700 to $500 and, you know, and has to file the paperwork with Medicaid before he can get a
patient. I mean, my dad's a physician. He can't even then afford the medical malpractice insurance. People aren't living in the real world that don't live and work as a physician like you do. And I think you point out the whole debate's a fraud. Back before we had medical insurance, we even had, you know, better access to health care. It becomes just this bigger and bigger fraud, this bigger and bigger scam where the expenses of the bureaucracies go up and the media is saying it's the doctors getting the money. I see the statistics. Doctors in the last 20 years, in many cases, are making half of what they were.
You know, people ask me all the time, why aren't doctors fighting? I'll give you a couple of answers for that. The number one, you're not going to believe, which is they're too busy taking care of patients. Number two is most doctors realize that they're being steamrolled and they don't feel that there's anything to do about it, so why waste the time? But there's going to be a rude awakening in a few years if this gets slammed down. Doctors are going to revolt. And I'll have to tell you, full disclosure, here's how doctors revolt. They either drop out or they game the system. Now, do patients want that? You want to be gamed? You want your doctor to drop out? Let's deal with a real myth that you're going to get to keep the doctor you got now till he quits. You know, great quote. Get to keep the doctor you have now. So, you know, physicians are being completely ignored in this whole discussion. And a few of us have loud voices, but clearly the debate would you have a debate about who's operating your train without talking about the conductor? Would you say let's pad the seats, let's get new dining cars? By the way, the engineer's quitting. Who's driving the train?
Well, that's like the government says they're going to put screen doors on submarines without consulting the engineer who designed the submarine.
It's totally the case. And I don't want your listeners to think, by the way, that I only care about doctors, but there's a trickle-down effect here. Because everybody knows that when you go to the doctor's office, you're not meeting President Obama, you're meeting your physician. And it's not that and by the way, one more thing that I don't think I've ever said before. I want to make a really, really important point here. You know, doctors are not the same doctors that we were dealing with in 1964 when Medicare came down the pike. Those doctors were definitely living high on the hog, and there was a lot of fat on the bone. Now, I don't happen to think the fat was chipped off the bone in the right way. I don't think HMOs work very well, and I know that the government insurance doesn't. But the doctors we have now are very close to the bone. They have very, very high overhead. They're working their butts off. They're seeing 40 patients a day. What do you want them to see, 60? I mean, let's flood their offices with millions of more patients and pay them less, and hospitals we're going to cut?
I mean, well, I've seen it with nurses. That's why they've got such a shortage there. I mean, it's a hellish job because they are overworking everybody. And they use a few specialists on TV to demonize the profession. In the 5 minutes we got left, I want to plug your website. It's drsiegel.com. That's drsiegel.com. I wanted to specifically get into eugenics, though. You said it's almost like eugenics. Well, the bioethicist boards have a lot of eugenicist ideas in them. Europe, as you know, they've said if you're old, you don't deserve the same care as a young person. We know that Daschle's book said, if you're old, you don't deserve the care. So, can you elaborate as a well-known, prominent physician, why you use the word eugenics?
Because we're trained in medical school not to make any difference between one patient and another. I've talked about that endlessly and thought about that. I don't treat, you know, overweight people differently than skinny people, except that I might focus on being overweight as a problem. I don't say, this patient has no money, I'm going to treat them less. I don't say this person's rich, I'm going to treat them better. My patients wouldn't have it any other way. So where's the government coming along saying, you know, things like Ezekiel Emanuel has written about life years? Too many life years? I mean, what is that all about? Why don't elderly deserve the same care as young people? A patient is a patient is a patient. That's the only way doctors can practice, and it's the only way healthcare can be delivered, and it's what the United States wants.
And they're phrasing it in the media and the government like it's good, like you want the government taking tests away. You want the government giving you a aspirin for a heart attack like Cuba. I mean, this is crazy.
Well, I don't think the government, I think the biggest issue with the government, by the way, is that they don't have the qualifications. And, you know, never mind that they do such a great job with the IRS and with the post office. But they, you know, they're just learning their talking points now. I mean, they're going to seminars and tutorials on healthcare. I mean, you can't, you know, that's the thing that's most disturbing here of all. I watch politics with a jaundiced eye to begin with. But where do these guys get off thinking they can be healthcare experts? That's the biggest bearing of false witness here to begin with. I mean, where'd this guy get an MD from? You know, we're in this for, I've been in this for two decades already, and I'm not just a practicing physician. As you know, I'm writing about this. I've been writing about health policy for 10 years. I've studied this very carefully. There's too many people in this dealing with this, ramming this down our throats, who are not qualified to be looking at health care and health reform.
But they are qualified to steal 20% of the country's economy that's not under government control so they can give it to their fat cat buddies is now coming out. In closing, the flu. I've seen no U.S. media. I'd love for you to break this nationally. You've got the power to do it. The Sunday Mail, the London Telegraph, German News reports, swine flu jab linked to killer nerve disease. Leaked letter reveals concern of neurologists over 25 deaths in America in the test alone of the vaccine by Gillian Bernays and other deaths of neurological, switching on some autoimmune response, massive brain swelling. Doctor, your comments on this and the news saying three shots could mutate in the body.
Well, look, I think it's a mild virus. I think that, as you hinted before I came on, we don't know how it's going to be hyped yet. We don't know what the administration's going to do to hype it. I think it's a mild virus, but I do think it's made its way around the world, and I think we have to pay particular attention to it. I don't think we can ignore it, but the hysteria is totally ridiculous. I think we need a vaccine to it, but the vaccine that is problematic, because in 1976, we had a what we thought was a swine flu epidemic, which was completely fabricated, it turned out, and we ended up with close to 1,000 cases of ascending paralysis as a result. That could happen again, but I don't want to use fear of the vaccine to replace fear of the virus. I don't like fear in general. I've written books on this. And
but doctor, we got 30 seconds. My issue here is that internal CDC, they're saying, were you aware of this? It's not in our news.
I'm aware of it.
You are aware?
I'm aware of it, but I don't know to the extent to which it's a problem versus 76. In other words, it remains to be seen how significant a side effect this is. Before I go and tell people, be afraid of this vaccine, I want to see more about what a risk this really is.
Exactly, but they're keeping it secret, so shouldn't that be public? Shouldn't there be a big debate about this?
There should be a big debate about this, but I'm telling you right now, I'm always on the side of the facts, and I want to close by saying I think the vaccine is going to be safe.
DrSiegel.com. Doc, thanks for talking to us.
Oh, my pleasure. Anytime.
You bet.